Hi, welcome to this special Lenten series, Journeys with Jesus. Each week during the season of Lent, we invite you to view this video and to take time to be able to meditate on the questions posed within it. This is a service of prayer, it's a service of music. It's a chance to be able to decompress from the week and to gather your thoughts and to find ways that you can connect up with what God is doing in your life and how you can continue to be part of the mission of God in this world. So we invite you to take some time to decompress, to relax, to find a place where you can enjoy this particular worship experience. And hopefully, as you journey with Jesus around the Sea of Galilee and down into Jerusalem, this Lenten season can be one filled with hope and peace and energy as we go forward to the Easter season. We prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Almighty and eternal God, the only hope of the world, by the proclamation of your prophets, you declare to us the word of salvation. By the grace of your Spirit, increase the devotion of all the baptized, that strengthened by your presence, we may withstand hardship and sorrow and be united with your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our reading tonight comes from the Gospel of Luke. Luke writes, Jesus stood still and ordered the man to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, What do you want me to do for you? And he said, Lord, let me see again. And Jesus said to him, Receive your sight. Your faith has saved you. Immediately he regained his sight and followed Jesus, glorifying God and all the people when they saw it. Praised God. So this man has been blind. And Jesus says to the guy, What do you want me to do for you? And he says, Let me see again. And I've always been fascinated by this because if Jesus was known as a healer, you know, and so if you bring a blind guy to Jesus, didn't he know what the guy wanted?
I mean, what if the guy had said, well, what I really want is I was thinking of being able to be ambidextrous and be able to use both hands. I mean, what would Jesus have done then? He was like, no, I was hoping you'd say blindness. So what's interesting here is that even though it's obvious, this man is blind, Jesus still asks him what he wants. Doesn't presume to know what this guy wants. In other words, this man is brought to Jesus blind, and Jesus says, what can I do to help you? And for all of us around, we're like, well, the guy's blind, help him see. That might be obvious, but Jesus doesn't want to intrude on this man and on what he wants. And so he asks him, and the guy does say, I'd like to see again, and Jesus grants it to him. But this is an interesting and intriguing piece for our Lenten journey as we walk with Jesus. If Jesus was to come up to you and say, what do you want me to do for you? Or what can I do for you? What would your answer be? I mean, do you know what you want? Do you have something like this man who is blind? Do you have something you can obviously say, I want to be healed, or I want to be free, or I want this or that or the other thing? Perhaps it's obvious to everyone and that's what you want, but what if what you want is not obvious to Jesus, to the people around you, maybe even to yourself? And so as we use this time to contemplate what it is that you would want Jesus to do for you. If Jesus enters your life and says, how can I help? How would you answer that question? There's a great movie called Bedazzled. It's had a couple of different incarnations. Don't matter which one you get, though, the beauty of this particular movie is that there is one man who's a sort of a put upon a man in the world and makes a deal with the devil for 7 wishes. And the first 6 don't go as planned. And so frustrated with the way those first 6 have gone, the last wish is given to someone else so that they could be happy. And in doing so, this person voids the contract with the devil and becomes free. And the wish and the life continues to move on. So perhaps if you're thinking about what Jesus could do for you, don't think about it in terms of just you, but think about it in terms of us. Us and what we can do for each other. And perhaps if Jesus then comes to you and says, what can I do for you? The answer might not necessarily be, let me see again, like it was for the man who was blind, or for somebody else who has a need, and those are certainly legitimate. But it might also be for us and what Jesus can do for all of us. So let's take a few moments to reflect on what God can do for you. Thank you. Gracious God, as Jesus enters into our lives, continue to encourage us to state what we want or what we need, and to clarify how your grace can make our world livable and filled with hope. Amen. Welcome. Tonight I have with me Mike Bakey. He is the chair of the stewardship committee here at First Lutheran Church. And so thank you for being with me, Mike. How'd you get started on the stewardship committee?
Well, I think I was approached and asked if I would consider spending some time on the stewardship committee. At that time, we did not have an active committee. It had been dormant for a few years. And in the beginning, I think we were searching for roads to explore and to things to do. And in the first 2 years, Glenn and I had the opportunity to attend speakers from the ELCA who had authored a book, and that book sort of became the pathway of ideas that we tried to employ the last 2 or 3 years. The book is Embracing Stewardship. And we bought books for everybody on the stewardship committee as well as the council. And I think it's a great book, because the thing that I became aware of or got reinforced is that if we start with the premise that God created everything and everything is God's, that He has bestowed to us in the form of giving us time, giving us talents, giving us treasures, then it comes back to us, and each one of us have to decide what things of God do we need to give back to God. And I think when you read the Bible, there are so many passages that talk about how we should live our life, and it is the living of that life, giving of those three things, not just necessarily to First Lutheran Church here in Blair, but I think this is what we're meant to do each and every day of our life, in our community, in our society. And I think it's just a great way to think about stewardship, is this is a pathway through life. This is the way we're supposed to be. It's not just necessarily reaching for your back pocket and pulling out your wallet.
Right.
It's a way to live your life. And
yeah.
So that's what stewardship has come to me in the last 3 years, as we have tried to employ various activities that maybe didn't concentrate so much on the cash end of things, but giving to First Lutheran those things that would be of your time or of your talents,
right,
as well as of the cash that we need to carry on the missions and ministries of First Lutheran. So we have embarked, I think, on a few different activities here the last 3 years that maybe often aren't realized by the congregation at large, but we have a thank you program in place now where each quarter we send out thank yous for those people that are giving of their times and talents. We tried to solicit that over a broad base, because there are so many things that,
right,
First Lutheran undertakes. Some of the things that we've undertaken haven't been successful, and I think my biggest disappointment has been in trying to reach new audiences. We were targeting a group of congregants that we were trying to get closer to through a couple different efforts. I just felt that we fell short. The short term is, Glenn Anderson and Mike Tupa and myself could use 3 or 4 people from the congregation to join us on the stewardship committee. That would be the short-term goal,
okay,
is that we could increase the number of people on our committee. Looking out on a longer horizon, we're going to be rolling out a program or a campaign later this spring, the start of summer, where we are going to come to the congregation and we are going to ask for money. The goal is to retire our debt earlier than would be the case otherwise. But we'll get the details of that and our theme and the dates later this year, but our goal is if we could retire our debt, we feel that we have repairs, we have other things in our ministries here at First Lutheran that would benefit from those cash needs, or have cash needs for those other programs.
So the way that we're looking at it then going forward is there's going to be some kind of a capital campaign of some kind to work on retiring our debt, and the congregation should continue to keep that and in their prayers as they go forward.
If they would, yes.
All right. Well, thanks for being with us, Mike.
My pleasure.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for God's people, the world, and all in need. I'll end each petition, hear us, O God. You may respond, your mercy is great. From east to west, your steadfast love is shown. Nourish seas and deserts, wilderness areas and cities. Give water to thirsty lands. Nurture spring growth that feeds hungry creatures. Bless farmers as they prepare for the growing season. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You sustained your people in the wilderness. Give courage to all who lead in times of crisis and scarce resources. Prosper the work of those who aid victims of famine and drought. Bring peace in places where scarce resources cause violence. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Blessed Jesus, your mercy endures forever. Deliver all who cry to you, especially those who are hungry or without homes. Give life in places where death seems triumphant. Give sight to the blind and healing to those who are sick. Comfort those who grieve. We'll take a few moments of silence to remember all of those who have a special request before God on this day, especially those who are suffering from the effects of COVID-19. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. By grace we have been saved. Fill this congregation to overflowing with that grace, that we show mercy to others. Nourish any in our midst who are hungry, especially children, and bless our midweek meal. Give us patience and courage when the way seems long. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Your Son was lifted up that whoever believes might have eternal life. We praise you for all who have died in Christ. Bring with us, with all the saints, the fullness of your promises, especially as we remember Alice Jorgensen, Chris Schroeder, Jerry Wilkie, and all those whom we name in our hearts. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please receive the benediction. And as we go out into this evening, may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord's face shine on us and be gracious to us. And may the Lord's holy countenance smile down upon us as we journey with Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Pass me not, O gentle.